This is MJ with MinIO, and welcome back to the MinIO and Kubernetes and MinIO Operator course. In this video, we're going to do a full lab walkthrough of installing MinIO and Kubernetes with the manifest files. This particular video is going to be about K3S. We will do another one on K3D. So if you followed along with our lab setup guides and you're using one of our K3S or K3D labs that we showed you how to set up, then you can follow this video and you should be able to get MinIO up and running using the manifest files and some of the custom configurations that were necessary. So again, this is just for lab setup. I will walk you through the steps, but this is not going to be a lot of slides. It's going to be almost entirely command line driven. So the first thing we're going to do is download the MinIO Kubernetes YAML file, and we'll take a look at that. We will need to, at least for our environments, modify the YAML for our specific configuration. Next, we'll be deploying the MinIO Kubernetes YAML files and verifying that the pods are up and running. Again, this is optional, but there is instructions to do port forwarding, and depending on your environment, port forwarding may or may not work. So I will show you how to create node port services for the console and the API so you can have persistent access to these environments. Next, we will access the MinIO console, and we will also access the S3 API with the MinIO client in this video. So let's dive into the lab environment now. So here we are in our lab environment, and the first thing we're going to do is make sure that we are on the correct lab environment. I actually have two set up, but here's what this should look like if you are running a single node K3S cluster after following our instructions on how to set up that cluster. This is K3S with DirectPV for the persistent volume storage. So let's do a kubectl get nodes. And you can see here that we are running a single node K3S running version 1.26.5 of Kubernetes. The next thing we're going to do is download our standard configuration file from the link. We'll put this link in the description. We'll do a curl of this file. And if we do an ls, we will see that there is a MinIO dev YAML that we just downloaded here. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So again, you can get a better look at this by going to the documentation page, but essentially this is sort of a generic configuration for deploying MinIO in a single node dev test type environment. You should not use this from production, but this is just to show that it can run on Kubernetes. If you're looking to run on Kubernetes in production, you should use the operator. There's some future videos coming out for that. So what you'll note here is that there are a number of things defined here, like a namespace, as well as a pod for running MinIO. It's called MinIO dev for a reason, because again, this is a dev environment. But there's a couple of unique things about this. One is that we're using the local volume path, and if your system has local volume, that should work, but we're running DirectPV, so we do need to make some modifications there. And along with running on DirectPV, we actually need to add in a persistent volume claim, or PVC, to actually go and grab some space from DirectPV. So this file will not work on this system. And again, depending on the system that you're running, it may not work on yours and you will need to customize this. But let's go ahead and load up our custom file. So we'll do a nano minio dev custom.yaml. And we will put in our configuration file that's been customized based on what we just downloaded. So let's go ahead and step through this before I save this file. You can see here that we are defining a namespace of MinIO dev. In the next section, we are adding the pod in the same way and exposing port 9090 for the console address. But when we get down here, what's different is that we are mounting it to a MinIO DirectPV volume. And so we've given that a specific name. We've also asked for the claim MinIO DirectPV volume and MinIO DirectPV PVC. And then we are now giving it a persistent volume claim that references our storage class of MinIO DirectPV. You can see here the storage class name of DirectPV min-io. So that is the actual storage class name that's loaded up in our K3S cluster, and that needs to be exactly as it is exposed within K3S. So with these components, we should be able to get this up and running with a single command after this. Oh, one more note. In the original videos, I had a slightly larger deployment of DirectPV. This is just a small test cluster, so I'm only provisioning 5 gigs of storage. Do not provision over what your storage capabilities are. So originally I had 50, but right now I'm only using 10 gig drives. So make sure, again, that you understand your underlying storage infrastructure and that you are appropriately sizing your requests so that it actually fits within that space. If you do not, then you will likely run into errors. Go ahead and save that. And now we can do kubectl apply minus f and minio dev, and we created a custom file. So there's that custom file applied now. You can see that it created the namespace, it created the pod, and it created the persistent volume claim. Now we can go ahead and go and check and see if these pods are actually up and running. We'll do kubectl get pods minus n, because we have to specify a namespace. Minio dev is our namespace. And you can see that this pod is up and running. Let's go ahead and describe that pod as well. You can see here that the pod started successfully and it is running on our node. And you can also see that it's pulling in data from that direct PV volume that we mentioned here, and it's linked to that. You can also see some logs from this pod just to get some information about what's actually happening inside the pod. So you can see that here it's indicating that this is up and running, that we've used the default credentials in here. Definitely recommend that you go and change those. Also, again, we're getting the internal IP address of the pod. So this is not the information that you will use to actually access this. We're going to have to provide a way to access this outside the cluster, because you're not going to go directly in from the outside and access an underlying pod for this. So we're going to skip over the port forwarding portion, because we've determined that, at least in our environment here, that it does not work consistently or at all sometimes. And so we're going to jump right into actually deploying a node port service and providing some long-term persistent access to this cluster. So let's go ahead and create that now. Go ahead and create that file. And here's the configuration for that. So we have defined two services. We're calling them Minio service and Minio API service. So one of them is going to access the UI and the other is going to access the API. We are providing the proper namespace in both of these. We are selecting the app label, which is Minio, which was included in the deployment that we did of the Minio pod. And we're specifying a type of node port here. And we're exposing externally on our host port 30,000 to access the UI. And we're targeting port 9090 inside the pod. Same goes for the API. We are exposing port 30,001 and targeting port 9000, which is the API port on our pod that's running inside there. So on our host, we will be able to type our host IP 30,000 and get to the UI, and our host IP 30,001 and get to the API port. We'll go ahead and save that. And now we will apply that. We can now see that there are two node port services created now. And with that, we should be able, lastly, to go and access these using our IP address and either 30,000 or 30,001 and get to the Minio deployment that's running on our host. So here we are in our web browser, and you can see that I've accessed this using my IP address of my K3S node, 30,000, and it brought me to the login page. So let's just go ahead and make sure we can log in right now. And the next thing you want to do is just go ahead and create a bucket, make sure things are working as expected. So we'll go ahead and create a bucket called test bucket. And if we go to the object browser, we can see that we can access the test bucket. And let's just go ahead and upload a test file. So we'll go ahead and upload a 5 meg test file here. That worked successfully. And we can see that that test file is here, and we can get information about this. And we should also be able to download that test file, and it downloads successfully. So our Minio instance is working from a UI perspective right now. Let's go ahead and jump back over to our CLI, and we will add this to the Minio client and make sure that we can access the API port using Minio client. So here we are back in our terminal. Let's first make sure that our Minio client is working as expected. So we'll do mc --help. And you can see here that it gives you all the commands that you can use with the MC client in this context. So the next thing we're going to do is add an alias for the server that we just set up running in our K3S cluster. And we will go ahead and add that as an alias called Kate's MinIO dev on this host. So you see, we will say MC alias set. The alias that we want to call this is Kate's MinIO dev. We will access HTTP. Remember, we have not set up TLS yet, so this should just be pure HTTP. And our IP address and 30,001, because that is the service that we pointed into the pod to access the API. And then our default credentials here are MinIO admin and MinIO admin. And you can see that that was done successfully. If we type MC admin info Kate's MinIO dev, then you can see that this has been up and running for 7 minutes. There is one drive and we are using 5 megs, which is that 5 meg file that we just uploaded. Lastly, let's make sure that the MC client can actually see the file that we've uploaded. So first we'll do MC LS for list and Kate's MinIO dev. And you can see that there's a test bucket listed here. And if we actually take a look inside that test bucket, we can see the 5 meg file that we've uploaded from the UI. So that's the basic walkthrough of the steps that it takes to customize that YAML file and actually deploy MinIO, open up services to access this, and then to access the UI, upload a file, and then attach the MC client to this and also perform functions against this cluster. Hopefully this consolidated walkthrough of just the installation of the MinIO manifest files helped you out. Please look forward for more videos coming in the future around the operator and the full operator setup. We hope you've learned something in this video, and thanks for watching. Talk to you soon.